Hey everyone, it's me PhD, and today I wanted to go over the stock that I have owned, have traded, DXL Group. They have pretty much plummeted. I was trading the stock around, where is it? Right around here. I bought in, actually at the highs, I bought in around 7, yeah, basically the highs, 75 cents or so. I'll throw up what I was previously trading and, you know, what I currently own at some point, maybe at this point. But initially I bought into the stock because I saw people looking to buy $2.50 call strikes for this stock, which I found to be crazy. I think there was talk of it being bought out, but that, in my opinion, was very unrealistic. I was just looking to sell covered calls, buy them back, and then sell the stock because it seemed like a pump and dump at the time. I did end up bag holding some shares, and I, to this day, still have some. Later on, I ended up buying at the lows around here, like 23 cents, 20 cents. You'll see on the photo what exactly price it is. So I currently do have 2,200 shares. In this video, I just wanted to go into, I wouldn't call it a deep dive, but it's deeper than some of the other videos you see on YouTube. Just random people talking about, is the price going to go up or down by looking at charts? I'm going to go into maybe some more anecdotal, what I see as evidence, dissecting what I could from the earnings call they had back in November for the third quarter. I'm going to also show some clips of that. So before I get into dissecting some of the calls, I want to go over some things that I think are, in my opinion, positives for the company going forward, and then some negatives. So the first positive would be that, well, the economy is going to be reopening. I'm not going to get into the politics of it, but I believe the Biden administration will want to reopen workforce jobs, commuter jobs, jobs that require actual suit, tie, and blazer, you know, if you're in that industry, obviously. Yeah, there might be some companies that might keep the casual work environment remote to work. But if the companies have, you know, or long-term leases for downtown facilities, they're probably going to want people coming back to work. And so you have Kumo here talking about how he wants to reopen the economy in his own way. I think he's pushing for like bars and pubs or whatnot. Or that could be, you know, the Chicago mayor. But, you know, these are head figures in the Democratic Party. And if they're talking about how they should be like reopening bars and stuff, this is going to extend on further as months pass into other fields, places where large buildings and people congregate to work at desk jobs. So these are what I see will increase sales in tailored suits, away from casual clothing. I guess I'll put in a clip of one of the earning call questions, and you have upper level management talking about how they think they're going to be selling more casual clothing.
Continue to drive down the path of looking to take share of market. And we are on TV more frequently. We started, I think our first TV was on the 9th. We are predominantly in places that you would expect to see us around football and the NFL. We have some extensions into what I would call either syndicated or current live TV in the evenings at drive times, but primarily in places that are either target or active customer needs to be reminded that we're still here. And those are being done more frequently with an attempt to both create incremental reach and incremental reach and frequency, or TRPs as it's referred to. And our hope is that it will address the casualization element as well. So if you remember prior year ads and looked at this ad specifically, you will see a much stronger orientation around casual and much less, if really any, specifically referring to tailored clothing.
So here you hear him talking about casual clothing. The thing is just generally speaking, you can make more money on casual clothing because it's less tailored to a person. Although tailorization, you know, tailoring suits and whatnot has higher margins, given that it's a more personal item. In a way, though, later in the conference call, they mention how they are cutting suppliers and focusing more on a few main suppliers for clothing items. I think that's a smart idea because you don't want a store with a bunch of random stuff that maybe one person might buy a pink tie once in a blue moon. When you're focusing on more work-centered clothing or casual clothing, it just feels like it's a smarter thing to do to focus on a few categories and hit those categories hard with higher inventories than getting random products that someone may or may not use. So that's what I took away from this part. This is what I'm referring to, where upper management talks about the narrowization of product lines.
Well, our goal certainly is to narrow it, and I think we've talked about this pretty publicly. Literally, our vendor base for 2021 has almost been cut in half. And Allison is our head merchant, and Katie, our leader of planning. The two of them have put their heads together and really narrowed in the assortment, really invested in the most meaningful parts of the mix. And our merchants have done a phenomenal job working with our really important brands, as you might imagine, Ralph Lauren, Vineyard Vines, Psycho Bunny, all the brands that we've continued to really drive into, and they have been great partners in helping us steer. So we do expect that between the curation of the mix, which is greater than it's ever been before, and the specific intent to try to turn faster, there is meaningful upside, and yet we're balancing that risk appropriately.
So I know management is focusing on the casual work from home type clothing. I do think, as I said before, that once the economy reopens up further, people are going to be going back and getting tailored suits, more less casual clothing for work. Another thing that was eventually touched on was how DXL has their partnership with Amazon, selling on Amazon's essential line of products. So my first fear was that, well, you know, Amazon likes to basically cannibalize companies. They learn about how they can make products with the help of partners, and then they cut them out entirely and do their own thing. Some of those fears were put to rest, and I'm going to play that clip right now in the entirety of the question.
One final question, if I may. Could you amplify a little bit on the Amazon relationship? I didn't catch all of the details in terms of the, the bumps along the way, but it seems as though the relationship has a lot of potential looking forward. What would you say about that?
Yeah, I would concur completely. I mean, the reality is Amazon has been no different than us in some respects, and specifically trying to understand the customer and how fast they'll buy. In our case, the Amazon Essentials program initially had some challenge, no different than anybody else. It came back very strong, so strong that it created the highest level of out-of-stocks we've ever seen for the program. Those out-of-stocks, given the manufacturing, supply chain logistics, vessels, and what have you, we chased them hard. And as we've gotten back in stock, I would not say we're where we want to be at negative 30% in terms of out-of-stocks, but the business is trending measurably ahead of last year. And as those out-of-stocks get reduced further and further, we think there's upside. Amazon, as we shared on our opening comments, felt so good about the business and the opportunities for the business. We've expanded that to the Good Thread line, which the Good Threads line is literally a second private brand within their private brands program. And I wouldn't go on to characterize how many private brands they have, but if you look at their business, there's not that many. It's a pretty narrow, finite group of companies they work with to create their private brand program. And because we had two, and we're getting behind one and we'll drive the second, I feel great about the opportunity. They are a great partner addressing a customer base that for us is different from our core customer. And as a result, we believe it's additive and not cannibalistic.
So while it's good that DXL is kind of branching out and they're doing a low-cost third-party distribution through Amazon as a quote-unquote wholesale route, it only really accounts for about $5 million in revenue, and unless they can somehow 2x that or 3x that in the next year, I don't think it's a big moneymaker for them. I mean, it's great. Obviously, it's like extra money, but it's not something that's going to propel this company, you know, into a higher stock price point. Something that relates to this is direct sales, direct e-commerce sales. They mention it that includes DXL.com sales, but also in-store purchases, because sometimes customers can go into store, they don't have the item they want, so the store will directly order from DXL.com and have it shipped to store. So with the increased sales of direct-to-consumer via their website and the way they've talked about trying to sell more casual clothing items to consumers rather than more tailored items, it's possible that DXL is trying to minimize their in-store footprint and are using digital sales ads and TV commercials to target people to their website instead. Clearly, that would minimize their inventories further, as you wouldn't be having so much tailorization unless somehow they hit markets near stores that they currently had access to do such tailorized items. Possibly they'd keep stores in big cities and eliminate stores that are more in the suburbs, or maybe, you know, I don't know, something, and they can figure it out. DXL was nice enough to show the breakdown of stores they have. You know, this shows from 2017 to 2020 how they've somewhat expanded. CMXL is in Canada, so that's really what that means. And so, you know, they break it down. They say 52 stores are coming back up on the least chopping block this year, and then 44, and then the bulk of which is 220, 22, you know, in basically 2023. So 52 stores is really only like 16-17% of all the current stores they have. I don't know that they would be cutting them all and then transitioning into an online only kind of business. I don't think that's realistic. And actually, I think that would be very detrimental to their projected cash flow in Q4. So it is more likely that they might be able to get a more favorable lease term agreement with a lot of these landlords. And it's mentioned on the call that, you know, it's individual landowners that are leasing them spaces. It's not like a Simon Property Group or a Kimco, you know, real estate trust, you know, leasing out properties to them. So realistically, this, all this here is they'll probably have cheaper leases given the times that we are in, and that the, you know, you hear all the crisis about stores are dying. It's all going online. Well, not everything's going online. So I will say DXL Group has some headwinds in the future. I don't want it to seem like it's a rosy picture for them, given that Biden has mentioned that he wants to raise the federal minimum wage to $15 an hour. This is, in my opinion, going to hurt the retail sector for DXL, because if they're only paying assistant managers about $14 or even $15 an hour currently, once 15-hour, you know, minimum wage hits, key holders are going to have to get paid $15 an hour. Either they'll have to cut staff in terms of key holders, or they will have to, you know, basically eat the cost, and also, in my opinion, raise the price, or, you know, raise the hourly wages of assistant managers and even yearly salaries of store managers, because why would you want to take on more work if you're getting paid the exact same as a key holder? Now, what they could possibly do is eliminate the in-store commissions for key holders, which is about 10 to 15% currently, I believe, of the total daily sales with the customers that they help. So that could be a way to minimize those costs. So another issue potentially is, will DXL have the right amount of cash to basically continue operations, but also to repay past due lease obligations that they had in 2020, given that they deferred a lot of those obligations due to their businesses being shut, but they still owe that money. And actually, on the call, an analyst asked a question on that. I'm not too well versed in it. I'm going to play that question and the answer that was given. Maybe that might give you some clarification.
Well, I was wondering whether or not where the adjustments in rentals show up, because these would seem to be, in my mind, accrued liabilities for where there's been deferral of rental.
Yeah, so you'll see those in the operating leases, which last year it was $233 million. This year it's $196 million. So all of the adjustments to the leases are coming through that operating lease line on our P&L, on our balance sheet.
But as you deferred rental payments during 2020, are some of these going to become due in 21 as additional expense?
Well, they'll be due as additional cash. So that's been part of our cash management strategy, and part of the reason why we've been able to maintain such a robust cash balance is because we have not had to make those payments this year, but they are deferred to next year. So they remain as accrued liabilities, but we were able to preserve the cash this year.
Okay.
And Bernie, in terms of the deferral, just so we're clear, our deferrals run very distinctly different for every landlord. In some cases, the deferrals could have started to come back in the fourth quarter from the second quarter. They could have been in 2021. They could be through the entire lease. So there was never one size fits all. Our deferrals, because we have so many unique one-off landlords, are very unique to each landlord's agreement and partnership.
So I brought up some positives and some negatives in this video, and I'm going to leave some links in the description that you can relook at this information and where I got it from and whatnot. I want to make sure you know I'm not a financial advisor. This isn't financial advice at all. Would I buy more of this stock at this price? Honestly, I wouldn't. It's not that I don't believe in the company. I think they have a shot of actually doing well in the future if they can, you know, cut their costs in store and actually bring more people into their stores and make sales. It's a possibility that they could do quite well. Stock-wise, like price stock-wise, I personally think this stock is going back to 25 cents or 20 cents before it rises higher. That's not to say that I don't believe it's going to hit a dollar at some point, and that's why I'm keeping my shares that I currently have, the 2,200, because at some point I do think this is going to get pumped back up to a dollar. But I wouldn't advise anyone to buy this stock just because they see it's, wow, under 40 cents. And, well, you know, with penny stocks, if it goes up a penny, you could make 1%. So that's just my take. This video wasn't trying to pump up this stock. I really just like reviewing some of the companies that I've bought into. Some of these quote-unquote penny stocks are... they have interesting backstories to them. And I mean, shoot, this, it's not like DXL Group's just a fly-by-night company. They've been around since like the, you know, the, I'm going to say 90s because 87 is like basically 90s, but like they've been around. So, you know, there's been a lot of retail companies or clothing stores that have gone under. So I'm pretty surprised they're still around. Now there's other parts in the conference call where one guy talks about if management or upper-level managers would start buying the stock at this price, and they mentioned that they had previously bought around a dollar. They didn't say that they were going to buy more stock on their personal accounts, but it could be a possibility if they actually do believe in the company that they might buy at this point at some point. I just haven't seen internal buying of the stock. So maybe they're cash strapped due to the pandemic as well. Finally, I'm going to leave you guys with just something that I found relevant to this discussion. And if DXL fires on all cylinders, people, shareholders, and people inside the company could see more market share be taken by DXL.
It's remarkable. In some specific cases, some of our very best brands, our inventories literally are down 40 and 50%, and we're chasing them incredibly well. In some cases, we canceled. In some cases, they didn't produce. But in spite of that, we have been in some weeks flat on negative 40 and 50. And as we chase and receipt more goods, that obviously is a win. The other thing is between our inventory levels, which no matter what will be down versus last year, and the reduction of expense and the reduction of lease, with just a little bit of sales momentum and a little bit greater than expectation, we will create incredible leverage. And we really have concentrated on giving ourselves the greatest opportunity from an operating standpoint to right-size the business. And in a downward environment, we think we've right-sized it, so we feel great about that. But if there is upside to what we expected, that downsizing will pay back measurably in leverage.
Anyways, thanks for watching the video, and leave a like if you liked it, and give me a comment, and ask some questions if you want. And yeah, thanks.